Mas de títulos, mas os dois lados, né?
Today, there's a gathering after Hildegard's speech at the main entrance, and then we go to the mystery concert. Tomorrow, we meet at 2 o'clock in the afternoon. Listen. Listening is, in fact, the most important thing in my life, and probably our speaker today, our speaker's life today as well. Sound. We perceive the reality outside through. Collective work of several senses. They all contribute to our consciousness and the way we perceive the reality both outside and inside of us. But sound plays a special role in this process. And it plays this role because sound is, in fact, as you were pointing out yesterday, inclusive. And sound is also sense is has another role of gathering the information from the other senses and making this a holistic experience. So the role of sound is important because of that. It is a gatherer of information, and it has this ability of producing this holistic consciousness. Well, the World Soundscape Project, which I should point out that is in the origin of all this wonderful and beautifully organized conference, has its roots in the World Soundscape Project and all the work that was done there, is a special experience in the cosmic ecology. Is a special experience because it depends on sound and the role it plays. So everything that is related to acoustic ecology contributes to gather and to include. Hildegard Westergaard is a symbol of all this. She came into this area, and I think I'm not disclosing any confidential information because she wanted to listen. Music was more a listening experience than anything else. So as a woman, as a composer, as a teacher, as a scholar, she has been doing, she has been taking this reality that sound provides us into practice. So it is a great honor to introduce Hildegard Westergaard.
Thank you, Carlos. My mother used to talk a lot, and I think she was the real teacher in my life to learn to listen, and I used to tell her that. I said, the reason I'm into listening is because learning to listen to your stories that repeated themselves over and over again for years and years was a major challenge in my life. So I thanked her profusely for that. I would like to also just have take the opportunity for all of us to thank Raquel for organizing this fantastic event and bringing us all here to the Azores. So can we have a big hand for So thank you, Raquel, for bringing us, me personally too, to this conference in this absolutely special location. Often, there are powers at play when we hear something, when we then make subsequent decisions and act on what we heard. There are other powers that we are often not aware of. You could not have known what other powers led me to stand here today, but by the end of this talk, you will. I invite you all, while listening to this talk, to trace your own journey to these islands and your motivations to be here, aside from being attracted to this intense and wonderful event. In the world of listening and acoustic ecology, context is everything. Understanding as much of the context as possible alters our listening and our comprehension of what we hear. It also makes abundantly clear that we cannot be aware of everything at all times. But let's at least be conscious that each one of us who presents work at this conference does so from a unique perspective that evolved from unique contexts. whether we choose to address this directly or not. For today's talk, I have chosen to address some of those more personal contexts that have informed my work, my listening and proposing, and my choices. Once we take listening seriously, in the context of acoustic ecology and soundscape studies, we know that the personal is always implicated. Our responses to sounds and soundscapes are never objective, can never be converted into scientific data without the loss of the subtle nuances that make each person's listening impressions unique. Listening is never static, and it implies constant shifting and perceptual movement. Michael Stoker describes this beautifully when he says that our experience with sounds unfolds as a continuous now. Not only does our perception move its attention through the multitude of sounds that it encounters in the environment, but it also shifts from those to our inner sound world and thoughts, and back again to the outside. This seemingly random movement back and forth occurs in highly individualistic ways for each one of us. If we become conscious of this, we can witness and perhaps learn to notice when, how much, and for what reason our listening attention is captured by our thoughts on the one hand and by the outside world on the other. I'm interested precisely in this transition from one to the other, that rather hard to grasp, ephemeral in-between moment of perception. It is there where I suspect we can find clues about the relationship between our personal innermost world and the larger issues we are facing regarding acoustic ecology and balance in the acoustic environment. This movement between inner and outer sound worlds in our listening practice is symbolic in my mind for a similarly fluid movement between our personal and professional lives. Much as we may try to separate them, at a certain point in our lives, and usually when the extraordinary occurs, such as births, deaths, falling in love, accidents, political upheavals, and so on, it is more obvious that the personal and professional flow together and influence each other. In many of our minds and in many professional contexts, the personal has been relegated into a place of lesser value, as if somehow it smudges the work with dirt, destroys its purity. It is precisely for this reason that I want to highlight today how certain experiences in my personal life have always informed and influenced my professional activities and creative work and vice versa. I'm approaching it as a type of a personal case study that may resonate with the universal and archetypal in all of us. Schubert's Symphony No. 9 in C major, known as The Great. In 1976, I decided to bring the whistle and the Schubert theme together in a composition created for the occasion of a family reunion. Its title, Familie mit Pfiff, was chosen because of its inherent pun in the German language. Literally translated, it means family with a whistle tune, but figuratively, it means family with zest. In the years leading up to the reunion, I had worked with the World Soundscape Project and discovered a deep enthusiasm and passion for the world of listening. All this led me to think of my wider family and the reunion from a fresh perspective. I realized that the whistle tune that had played such a big role in my childhood and youth may be in danger of disappearing. Increasingly noisy ambiences could mask it and discourage my attempts to whistle, any attempts to whistle it. I couldn't whistle, not my attempts. But perhaps more significantly, the increased mobility symbolized by transportation noise in the piece had already created a deeper interference in family connectedness. Many of us had moved away, even emigrated, and lived a very different life than our parents and grandparents. So while the theme of the composition that you just heard celebrates the whistle tune, the subsequent variations seriously question its survival possibilities in the environment of contemporary society. The title I gave to today's talk is The Practice of Listening in Unsettled Time. But actually it should be The Practice of Listening and Sound Making in Unsettled Times. In my master's thesis from 30 years ago, I argued a balance between listening and sound making, sound input and sound output, is essential to the health of the human acoustic psyche, and that the perceptive immediacy of childhood and the cultural work of artists offer strategies by which such a balance can be regained, even as contemporary urban soundscapes attempt increasingly to erode it. The impetus for wanting to research and explore what it means to achieve a balance between listening and sound making, both on a personal and wider social and cultural level, was rooted in a deep-seated imbalance that I had felt for a large part of my life. Classical music was powerfully beautiful in my childhood ears and often made me cry. For a long time, I interpreted this as a terrible weakness. Years later, when I was in my mid-30s and found myself in tears for the umpteenth time, but on this occasion, sitting in a restaurant, crying to some schlocky music tune in a minor key, I decided, enough already. I've got to look into this. So I set out to research the phenomenon of what I called music as environment in my thesis, and you can read that if you wish. Parallel to that, when I needed a break from my academic endeavors, I created a satirical performance piece entitled Cruel Drool. Here's a short excerpt from that, which was a live performance. I think that was the world premiere. A live performance during a Vancouver New Music concert in the mid-80s, and the recording quality is not great, but here it is.
I want to listen to background music because it affects me. The worst schwab can make me cry. Especially if it's in a minor key. Or if it's a Christmas tune. Or if I'm your mom. It makes me angry when that happens. We're all sophisticated listeners here. How can we stoop so low and helplessly sink into the swamp of Muzak Man? It's interesting to note that between 1963 and 1971, the Muzak Corporation was a wholly owned subsidiary of the Rather Corporation, who also owned Disneyland Hotel and the TV film series Lassie, Lone Ranger, and Sergeant Gressy. It seems politically and ideologically simply incorrect to cry to the tune of music. Nevertheless, it does affect me. If it affects me, it must affect others.
But like any good satire, the issues brought up in this piece were also deadly serious, both socially and personally. My vulnerability, symbolic here for every human being's vulnerable spots, was the perfect target for a profit-seeking corporation, the Muzak Corporation at the time. The thesis and the performance piece did not stop my tears altogether, but they helped for a new resilience to emerge in me after a little while. I had learned, and this is another quote from my thesis, that the creative process is a balancing agent against an overload of sound input, and that one's own sound output or creative expression not only lessens the authority of externally imposed voices, but also offers a new voice of vitality and energy. The discussion in my thesis focuses finally on the human body as a sound making listening instrument, and concludes that sound experienced, produced, and received as physical process can be an effective counterbalance to attempts by commerce and technology to transform it into product or commodity. That was 30 years ago. Now, we are faced with an American president whose lifeblood was made in the corporate world, whose sport it is to target human beings' vulnerable spots for his personal profit, and for winning an election, and for whom the environment, let alone the acoustic one, and global warming are unprofitable, and therefore of no concern whatsoever. His random Twitter words and public remarks, which really are the internal noise of a confused mind, externalized, have become weapons of attack, or defense, depending on the context, daring the aghast listener, enabling others to practice the same arbitrariness, and worst of all, finding power in it precisely by not listening to the heart or to reasoning, common sense, justice, or fairness. In the face of daily unsettling news and such non-listening, it has become an urgent matter in my mind to strengthen our listening even further. And as it happens, a rather fitting Zen quote landed in my email inbox at the airport in Vancouver when I was taking off for the trip to the Azores. I'll read it to you. Listening to another perspective doesn't necessarily mean we agree with it. We sometimes fear that if we take in another point of view, it will be mistaken for concession. But if we're clear in our own mind that listening doesn't mean agreement, we can open with confidence to other points of view. We can practice just listening with an open curious, and not knowing mind. We literally join with the perceptions of the other and become the same with them. Usually, when we listen, we still have boundaries in our mind. We want to share our experience, we are waiting to give advice, or we are holding a set of quiet opinions. Open listening is free from the usual barrage of unnecessary judgments and disapprovals that create divisions in our open field of sameness. A few months ago, a totem pole was erected on Pigeon Square in Vancouver's downtown east side, an area notorious for open-air drug trade, sex work, where many are homeless. On the base of the pole, an inscription reads, "Sing your song, friend. Tell your story. The map we inherited isn't any good. The old roads mislead. We need a new map." These words speak to all of us, really, in these unsettled times. And indeed, as the totem pole's carver, Bernie Williams, who's actually a rare woman doing the carving, she says, "This pole is for everybody. It represents the resilience of everyone who has faced racism, colonialism, sexism, LGBTQ bashing, gentrification, and more. These things have really affected this whole community. We want to let people know that we are here to stay, and this pole is a lasting legacy for all the people." The survivor's totem pole, as it is called, creates hope for healing. Its mere presence is the beginning of making such a new map. It is both a witness, or a listening presence, and an encouragement to find a voice. Sing your song, friend. Tell your story. In the late 1970s, when I broadcast my program Soundwalking on Vancouver Cooperative Radio, I would cross the same Pigeon Square on my way to and from the radio station.
Good afternoon. You're listening to Soundwalking, a radio program about the acoustic environment. My name is Hilde Westerkamp. Today you're going to hear the second part of Fog in Vancouver. What you're hearing right now is Pigeon Park, the square outside of Co-op Radio. We have the microphone hanging out of the window. We do this every Sunday at this time. We're listening for changes. And this is another form of soundwalking over time.
Pigeon Square, like the entire downtown east side, was a relatively harmless scene compared to what it is today, then consisting mostly of single men with alcohol problems. You can hear some of these men's voices from that time in this excerpt of my composition, A Walk Through the City, which comes from the year, I think, 1982. Oops, sorry.
That's right. kill the nail. No, Aaron, just walk around, walk around. You don't want to wait, you don't want to. No. Sometimes she eats, you know. Well, if she eats, you know, okay. If you don't, what is it? Just keep walking.
Uncomfortable information, issues we like to avoid. Listening in such a way requires courage, as it disrupts comfortable habits and routines. That in itself can feel threatening and elicit inner anxiety. Pema Chodron, a Tibetan Buddhist spiritual teacher, puts it this way. Whenever there is a sense of threat, we harden. And so if we don't harden, what happens? We are left with that uneasiness, that feeling of threat. That's when the real journey of courage begins. This is the real work of the peacemaker, to find the soft spot and the tenderness in that very uneasy place and stay with it. If we can stay with the soft spot and stay with a tender heart, then we are cultivating the seeds of peace. The seemingly simple act of listening to the environment often leads to unexpected complexities of thoughts, sensations, and emotions that are not always comfortable. On a sound walk, we may become aware of that fluid listening between inner and outer sound worlds that I mentioned earlier, and might find ourselves in a state of uneasiness as a result. But if we stay with the soft spot, as Pema Chodron would call it, then we can experience a sense of groundedness, what she calls peace. The nature of this fluidity between our inner and outer sound worlds is both highly personal and at the same time universal. It is here where the real and deeper journey of listening occurs, I believe. What I'm always asking in the sound walk is, and people don't often get it until they've actually done the sound walk and we can discuss it, is can you find the moment at which your listening goes from inside to outside or from outside to inside? What captures your attention more, your own thoughts and why? Or the sounds in the environment and why? What is it that captures your attention? And so really, one of the huge lessons in sound walks is more, you find out more about who you are as a listener than anything else. You may have gotten all sorts of information about the sound environment, yes, and if you want to study the sound environment, it's a great way to get close to it. But you're also understanding more about who you are as a listener. You're understanding that today, perhaps you were so preoccupied with your own thoughts that you had no time for the environment. And what was that? Why was that? And that kind of learning, I think, is part of the ecological learning, is part of trying to understand what is our relationship to the environment at any given moment, and how do we balance between our own inner reality and the outer reality.
How close then is what we're talking about to therapy, conventional psychotherapy?
Well, I think it's very connected, and it probably helps the process. In fact, one of the women in our Vancouver Soundboard Collective just told me that she's been taking people who are coming out of addiction on soundwalks in the downtown East Side. And she has told me some stories about how it has affected the listeners. And it sounds like that it has had a huge impact on some of them, that they suddenly were made aware of themselves as listeners who have a relationship to the environment. They've been made aware of that relationship and of who they are there and what role their listening might be playing in their healing process. To me, that was a lovely message to get from one of our Soundwalk leaders. And we were thinking we would might want to direct our Soundwalks more into that direction, because it's becoming absolutely urgent to learn how to heal. And you know, it's not an, drugs against overdoses that are going to do the healing. They're going to deal with the worst. But what happens after that? What happens after the people decide to heal themselves? What do we do then? And I think Soundwalks actually could be a great healer in that respect. And it and you've noticed it yourself, it calms us down. It connects us. It gives us a sense that we are connected. I think in urban environments, the problem is that we often feel so lonely and we feel so disconnected. And when we forget to listen to in that kind of active way, then also that disconnect is amplified. So yes, there's a therapeutic, there's a meditative aspect to it, just simply calms us, because we're not always speaking, we're not always putting out sounds. And that balancing between, you know, a 1 hour sound walk in a lifetime might do a lot of balancing to all the sound making and talking we do. If it becomes a regular practice, that kind of listening, if you can integrate that into your life as saying, okay, I'm just going to stop talking, I'm just going to listen, I think it can calm us down tremendously and put us in the present of, even though the present may be problematical and difficult, we can at least be grounded inside that difficult presence. Before we have an interview, and we did that, and it was a fabulous process, and as a result, the studio interview was also really very different. We'd gotten to know each other, and we were human beings talking to each other from Studio Vancouver to Studio Toronto. An occurrence after a recent sound walk with a class of students in the School for the Contemporary Arts at Simon Fraser University demonstrates the sounds that I've been making further here. Most of the students had iPods or cell phones that they bring daily, of course, they carry with them, and I asked them to bring them to the walk. They were to experiment with their habits of listening, but never to listen longer than 3 minutes at any given time, and most importantly, they were to listen consciously to the transitional moments of putting the earbuds in and taking them out. A few days later, I received an email from the instructor of the course. I wanted to share with you comments from one of the students who was deeply moved by the experience. She normally wears her headphones and listens to music on her way to the School for the Contemporary Arts, and after the soundwalk experience, a few days later, she decided to follow her normal route without headphones and attend to the sounds in the environment. She had discovered a new world of sound and image. It's a testimonial of sorts. This student really challenged herself and changed her daily routine. Always a subtle, often unnoticed moment of unease. But the result is usually inspiration, discovery, and a new freedom. Sound walks give us that chance to practice listening to the unraveling of that continuous now, as we are grounded in the movement of walking, and at the same time are learning to be mindful about our own sound making in this world. Recently, I heard about a performance that seemed to be a true expression of what I called earlier a balance in listening and sound making. It was entitled Music for Natural History and was created by Canadian sound artists Tina Pearson and Paul Wald in Victoria. Although I was not able to attend the live performance, I was struck by the incredibly skilled sound making I heard when Tina played to me recently the same excerpt that I will play to you in a minute. In the late 1970s, the Royal British Columbia Museum in Victoria created a natural history gallery with exhibits of taxidermied birds and mammals, human-made trees, painted landscapes, and an accompanying soundtrack of environmental sounds. This was rather advanced for its day, with some unusual special effects, all in order to draw the visitor into a sensual experience of the Pacific West Coast environment. Very unusual for museums at that time to do that. There's a few more pictures of, those are all painted. Music for Natural History was a live performance in that space, replacing the existing soundtrack with the live sound of 16 vocalists, sound artists, and music instrumentalists that spent weeks learning to viscerally replicate the sounds of wind, birds, mammals, and ocean surf of the Pacific Northwest. The creators of this performance called the piece part tragic love song for the wilderness, part performative sound art. I'll play you an excerpt now. Thank you. The artists say further that music for natural history is part of a growing global movement of art projects that intend to foster new connections with the biosphere. The project blurs boundaries between sonic mimicry, soundscape composition, classical music, and Dadaist sound poetry within the already paradoxical setting of the museum's exhibitions. Music for natural history might also be interpreted as a longing for remembering what we no longer hear and what we no longer see. The soundscape can be analyzed scientifically with sound level meters and a multitude of other measurement tools and data collection. Imagine if scientists would also learn to vocally reconstruct the soundscapes they measure and study. This might seem rather too radical if you consider how recent it is that our listening perception has been deemed important enough to be included in such analyses. The huge reluctance to be open in such studies to individual people's listening responses may be understandable, because inevitably they will throw wrenches into the smooth and clean results of data collection. And of course, this is precisely the difficult and easy part that Pema Chodron addresses when she talks about that feeling of threat, and when she proposes to stay with it and attend to it. In practical terms, this means that we, who have acquired knowledge and expertise in environmental listening and sound making possibly, that we take courage and offer our experience to those involved in academic and scientific studies of sound, acoustics, and soundscapes. If we are serious about wanting to effect real changes in our soundscapes, and by extension in us, we must never forget the practice of listening as a firm, if complicated, foundation for all our teachings, for our efforts to study and research the soundscape, and to understand the significance of acoustic ecology on our planet. Today, thanks to Raquel Castro's invitation to the Azores, I'm coming full circle via the family whistle tune and other sonic connections, remembering another event in my life that unsettled me and my family to the core when I was quite young. Times of crises tend to stop us in our tracks and remind us of what is important in life. Listening, when taken seriously, is exactly like that. I would call this the invisible forces of listening, one of those invisible places that Raquel is perhaps addressing in her overall title of this conference. The name Azores, Azores, die Azoren in German, has acquired what I would call an iconic ring in my ears. Its sound conjures up a traumatic time in my life. Accepting Raquel's invitation meant that I needed and wanted to listen to this ring again, this uneasy place, as Pema Chodron calls it, and listen to it more consciously and in this professional context of acoustic ecology and soundscape studies. Very nice. Thank you. Okay, so and now being right here on the Azores, seeing the Atlantic, feeling that's at Ferreria, seeing the Atlantic, feeling its mild, mellow, often very windy, humid air, and hearing its powerful waves is actually very moving. Sorry, it's another example without a fade, I'm sorry.
Thank you.
you, Seth, captured the power of those waves incredibly well just a few days ago down in Federia. On September 21, 1957, the German tall ship, the Pamir, sank in a hurricane, 600 nautical miles west-southwest of the Azores. This is really personal. Here it is, a beautiful ship. I was 11 years old then and heard the sound, the Azzurn, repeatedly on the many newscasts after the sinking of the ship. And during the week of searching for survivors. Newspaper headlines, the most intense media presence at the time, although silent, sounded like aggressive screams to me. My 22-year-old brother was on that ship, and he was among 80 men that were lost at sea. Six survived. It took me many years to understand that my brother's death also left a gift behind. This deeply unsettling event had given me early guidance in recognizing which situations in life would ground and inspire, who would be supportive, and who would not be. I did not realize it then that my listening towards the outside and towards my own inner sound world had received a first and tough training lesson. It actually became my guide in very unexpected ways. I thought I could do it without this, but anyways. Eventually, through various detours studying classical music, and never feeling right there, I became conscious of a deep sense of belonging and home in the world of sound and listening when I discovered Murray Schafer's work and the World Soundscape Project, and shortly after Pauline Oliveira's Sonic Meditations and Deep Listening. And when later a group of us founded and developed the now 24-year-old World Forum for Acoustic Ecology, and there's various people among the group here. Perhaps many of you here also have had such a moment of recognition that landed you in these invisible places of listening that carry much meaning and do the connecting work between inner and outer worlds, listening and sound making, between the personal and professional, the artistic and scientific. Knowing this invisible place is inspirational and should be celebrated precisely because it often may have involved difficulty and unsettling times in our lives. As it happens, it was my brother's birthday yesterday. Today is mine. Suddenly I'm 71. So there's much for us to celebrate in this amazing confluence of events and realities here on the Azores. So in conclusion, I will play you a short excerpt of my composition, The Harbour Symphony, that was originally performed by over 100 boats at Expo 86 for the opening of the Canada Pavilion in Vancouver. I had dedicated this piece to my brother at the time. Its performance was a big coming together party for the seafaring community in Vancouver, and sounded, as a Globe and Mail critic described it very poignantly, it sounded like a herd of happy elephants caught in a traffic jam.
Attention, the Harbour Symphony fleet. We're going to start the countdown for Harbour Symphony. Countdown starting.
Stand by for Harbour Symphony countdown.
Countdown starting.
Stand by for a countdown. It's coming now. Here it comes. Stand by.
5, 8, 7, 6, 5, 4, 3.
Thank you for listening. It was really kind of a chance composition. It was a huge organization. Luckily, I didn't have to do any organizing in terms of the seafaring community. I made an attempt to record as many horns in the seafaring community as I could so that I would get an idea of what kinds of sounds we would be hearing. I heard Joe Carter from Newfoundland, from the Sound Symposium in Newfoundland, had been the originator of the harbor symphonies that they played during the Sound Symposium every day, during that festival in the very contained harbor of Newfoundland. And he was the advisor for this harbor symphony, and of course it was a completely different scenario. As you can see, it wide open. Of course, there's downtown and Stanley Park, but it's not like in Newfoundland where you have these high cliffs, really, and it's a beautifully contained space, and you have seven boats, and seven or six boats, and they are usually freighters, quite large. What we had was really seen as a kind of a social celebration event for all the people who had boats in the community. So there would be fishermen, there were tow boats, and some private boats, and the big boats were not really in this area. They were further into the harbor, and they were quite far away, and you could hear them at certain points, but I also had no idea what kinds of horns they had, other than very low and beautiful ones. We lacked those low and beautiful ones, unfortunately. So I knew that there was going to be a problem in terms of not very good quality horns, about 50 or 60 of them, just squeakers really, some even just handheld. And so I decided to record the horns of the towing company boats that had very beautiful horns. And they were all designed by a company in Vancouver. Who had Bob Swanson, the owner of that company, had designed train horns in Canada, the fog horns, and some of these older beautiful boats. And there was a horn that he had designed that had you could play melodies on, that would belong to an old ship that used to go on picnics in the, I think, 30s or 40s, I can't actually remember exactly. So I decided to record those sounds and get them into my ear. And in one of the harbor sections in 3 minutes, the whole piece is 7 minutes long, 1 minute I decided, okay, I'm just going to put this little island of a known composition in there so that I know there will be about a minute of sound that I will like. And so these horns came into that minute. You didn't hear that, this was the beginning. And so that part was composed, but everything else was very unpredictable. I had every boat received a one-page score, and each line was a minute. And I had drawn for over 100 boats which boat would be blowing the horn at what point, and in what way. It was certain horns that had a variety of ways of being played. So it was really very much a kind of a chance thing. There was no rehearsal. I mean, there couldn't be a rehearsal. And I kind of tried to make a drawing for myself, a large kind of image for myself for the Harbor Symphony. So starting with a big blast, like the first minute. And then you heard at the end the O Canada horn, which is the sound mark that we have in Vancouver. And it was repeated on some of the other boats. And then it goes into a more gentle kind of time for a while. We also had three canoes of First Nations that did drumming, but they're very hard to hear in this recording. They were right at the Canada Places, that building with the sails. And they were right there where a lot of the audience was. And so they basically had their drums going the whole time. And there were also some ship bells on Canada Place itself, but they're not audible here. So this mix is a mix of probably from different perspectives, from Stanley Park, from Canada Pavilion, and then from a further east part as well. And we mix that together like that. And at the beginning, what you heard was the countdown, and these, throughout the whole time, the boats would have heard the second count throughout the whole time, because that's what they, what related to what they saw on the score. They were all pretty mystified when I first met some of the captains. They asked me what it was going to sound like, and whether it was going to sound like O Canada, for example. And then we had a sort of rehearsal just to give them a sense of the timing and the rhythm. So we filled a few bottles with water, beer bottles with water, and everybody blew on bottles just to get a bit of a sense of what it might be. Yeah, it was totally nerve-wracking and a lot of fun. Because normally, you know, my compositions are electroacoustic and ready-made on tape, and I control my sounds very carefully. This was the opposite. I'm now liking it. I thought that description of the happy elephants in the traffic jam was a really good one. Very appropriate. Any other questions? The beginning of the start with the World Soundscape Project. I studied music at the University of British Columbia in between 1968 and 72, right after I immigrated from Germany. And on one day, Murray Schafer was invited to give a guest lecture, which was probably in my fourth year. And that lecture just completely popped over my ears. And it was such a stunning experience of listening that I just never forgot it. And a few years later, I was teaching music in school and wasn't really all that enthralled with that. And someone told me that he had a research project and the World Soundscape Project, and they were working on the Vancouver soundscape at the time in the 1973. And I just decided right then, that moment, in the school and my lunch break, to phone Murray Schafer. And I phoned, and he said, yeah, what do you want? And I was a bit upset at this gruff tone, and I said, I can't talk about it on the phone. Can I see you? And he said, sure. So I went up to SFU, and he, we basically had immediately a very long conversation, and he happened to have gotten the grant at that point, and 3 weeks later, I started working with him, and then that was at the time when he wrote The Tuning of the World, and I was one of the researchers in that book, and I had landed in paradise as far as I was concerned, and was learning everything about sound, everything. Those of you who are familiar with the Tuning of the World or the Soundscape, and now that used to be the main title, the Tuning of the World, now it's called Soundscape, subtitle, the Tuning of the World, you will know that he's trying to cover really all aspects of the soundscape. Not only every kind of soundscape, but the history, trying to find out what the world sounded like 500 years ago through books. We had a literature file, it's called a literature file, and we collected quotes from books from times when there were no tape recorders. And that was one of my tasks, was to write down, put these on cards, type these cards out, and collect these quotes of descriptions of sound. And we read in literature, we encouraged others to read. A perfect project to do now with the internet, because you know you can post those things, you can much more easily collect those things. In fact, somebody should do this. It hasn't really been done. I think we have the existing quotes that we got at that time. They are on the World Soundscape Project website, as far as I remember. So that was one of them. But you know, we were discussing meanings of silence in different cultures. We were discussing noise issues. I was learning all about measurement, and we were learning about our ears, about the psychological effects of sound, psychoacoustics. We were really trying to cover as much as we could without being scientists. And Murray Schafer's goal, of course, always was at the time that we should really connect with the sciences who are already studying sound and the environment and acoustics. And that has been a difficult thing, and is something that is still difficult and is maybe perhaps a little bit more closer in the realm of the possible now. But still, if we, as many of us being artists, if we can learn as much of the sciences of sound, that way we can approach the scientific world. And if the scientific world learns to imitate sounds or goes on sound walks, for example, and includes the listening into, then there can be a meeting of that. And that is required, I think, when we talk about acoustic ecology, if we really want to be effective there. I think we need it all. Yeah, you could go on much longer.
Thank you. Thank you.